A team of archaeologists and scientists say that it has, for the very first time, found pieces of a burial shroud from the time of Jesus in a tomb in Jerusalem. The researchers from Hebrew University and institutions in Canada and here in the U.S. said that the shroud was very different from the controversial Turin shroud. The newly found cloth has a simpler weave than Turin's, and the body of a man wrapped in fragments of the shroud was found in a tomb dating from the time of Jesus near the old city of Jerusalem. And also, a Vatican researcher has rekindled the age-old debate over the Shroud of Turin, saying that faint writing on the linen proves that it was the burial cloth of Jesus. Experts say the historian may be reading too much into the markings, and they stand by carbon dating that points to the shroud being a medieval forgery. However, others say that's not the case. Up next, Barrie Schwortz joins us. Turin Shroud, the illustrated evidence, a remarkable story. Next on Coast to Coast AM. And welcome back to Coast, I'm George Norrie. Barrie Schwortz was the official documenting photographer for the Shroud of Turin Research Project, the team that conducted the first in-depth scientific examination of the shroud, and that was back in 1978, so 31 years ago. Barrie is the co-author of Turin Shroud, the illustrated evidence, also the editor and publisher of the internationally recognized Shroud of Turin website, the largest, most extensive shroud resource on the internet. And here he is, complete show tonight on Coast to Coast. Barrie, how are you?
I'm well, George, and thanks for having me back on the program.
My pleasure. It's always good to have you back, and fascinating work, by the way. And next hour, your friend Jerome Corsi is going to join us for just a bit.
I understand.
To add his input into the shroud. Lots of stories breaking, Barrie, about the shroud. Let's talk about them first before we get into your work.
Okay.
And that was, of course, they talked about a couple months ago that scientists have been able to create a holographic image of the shroud that shows that whatever it was, it levitated in the shroud. What did you think of that?
Well, you know, there was a beautiful holographic image created from the shroud photographs by a gentleman from Panama, Petra Soons. And it's a superb image that captures the spatial or three-dimensional information that's encoded in the shroud's image and amplifies it so that one can actually rotate it the way you would a normal holographic image, and you can see the shape and the perfection of the body. This is a perfect, basically three-dimensional image of a human form. Normal photographs and paintings just don't have that kind of information in them. As far as the levitation, that's a theory that some people have, that perhaps at some point, the body levitated. Again, from a scientific point of view, it's difficult to verify that kind of a claim. And typically, when somebody approaches me with that kind of thing, I say, well, look, you know, there's no way to scientifically confirm that.
Confirm it.
Sure. Remembering that I was a member of the only scientific team that ever examined the shroud, my focus has always been and continues to be on empirical science, preferably that published in peer-reviewed scientific journals. There's a lot of anecdotal information about the shroud. There are many theories pro and con the authenticity of the shroud. There are many agendas that are out there on both sides of the shroud authenticity issue. And my obligation is to stick really as much as I can to the facts. Remember, George, I'm Jewish, so I did not come into this with any kind of preconceived notions or emotional attachment, and I was a member of a scientific team that had members from Los Alamos National Lab and Sandia Labs and the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, so it was a real hard science team, not as some people have portrayed us over the years as a bunch of religious fanatics. So as far as the levitation goes, I really don't have much to comment on that. I really don't know about that.
Okay, now what about this Vatican researcher Barbara Fraley?
Yes.
Okay. What do you think of this story now, where
well,
she claims,
you know,
that this writing has to confirms that the shroud, of course, is authentic?
Well, you know, I have to apply the same standards to all these media releases that we hear, and sadly, these inscriptions that Barbara Frail claims are new information actually were first reported in 1997, and by 1999, they had been examined by linguists and scholars who were experts in ancient writings, and determined not to be valid, not to make any sense at all grammatically, historically, or even language-wise. I mean, in our own language, in the English language, we never have the letters X, Y, Z together in a word, and that's kind of some of the problems that were with these supposed inscriptions. So Barbara's work in that area is relying on old information from 97 that has really been sort of set aside as not valid. So I really, you know, I'm not sure what else she's claiming regarding these inscriptions. I do know that she said something about this being a death certificate and proving that, you know, that the shroud is authentic. But typically in first century, when criminals were crucified, they were typically left on the cross for, you know, days sometimes until their corpses were rotting, actually. And when they needed the cross for the next victim, they would take the bodies off and typically throw them into a pit for the dogs and jackals to eat, not the kind of, you know. They were not placed into common burial grounds, as she claimed, so that the families could then identify them a year later and come and pick up the bodies. That just was never done. There's nothing in the historic record that says that was ever done. So, again, I don't believe that Barbara's claims are, you know, anything new or important, even though they are pro-authenticity. You know, you have to rely on factual information. And, you know, there have been historically many people that have seen other things on the shroud, other kind of images and things, secondary images, I call them. And from my point of view, until there's something that's verifiable scientifically, and not just based on looking at old photographs of the shroud, where a lot of this is coming from, I would say that, you know, one has to discount them. The sad part of it, and I guess I'm going to stick my neck out a little here, is that all of these people making claims have a tendency to be selling a new book at the same time. And, you know, it's kind of tough to find something new about the Shroud of Turin, since they haven't really allowed it to be examined since we were there in 1978. So, you know, you got to come up with some new angle for the book, perhaps.
Absolutely. And they seem to come out during Christmas or Easter.
Well, even more coincidentally, the Shroud is going on public exhibit next year in April.
In its glass case, I assume, right?
In a special case, a special cabinet, bulletproof glass, argon nitrogen atmosphere purged the air out, temperature humidity controlled by computers. So it will be on public display. And it seems that every time it comes out on public display, starting about 6 months ahead of time, we start getting reports from skeptics proving it's a fake or from pro-authenticity people proving it's real. I know that some of the skeptical folks out there that are sort of the professional skeptics, some who you know, George, are planning a special issue of their skeptical magazine, debunking the shroud. And, you know, ironically, it'll probably come out in March or April. And, you know, I used to hear about people saying, oh, well, you know, there's a bias in the media. And I never saw that before. But the more involved I got with the Shroud of Turin, the more I realized there really is a bias. And the bias, well, I'll give you an example. Several months ago, a gentleman named Garlicelli in Italy, funded by the PsyCap, which is sort of a sister organization to America's PsyCop organization, came out with a thing. He had duplicated the shroud, reproduced it, proving it was a fake by using medieval technology and pigments from the medieval times. And, you know, he created something that looked very much like the shroud. Well, how tough is that when you've got my photographs and many other photographs available to use as a basis? Nobody starts from scratch on any of these things. They always use a shroud photograph, so it looks like the shroud. And Garlicelli said it was made of red iron oxide. And in the scientific data from 78, published in peer-reviewed journals, is a vast amount of evidence that proved it's not a painting, it proved it's not a photograph. And Garlicelli came out with the same old news again. Well, interestingly enough, he's got a book coming out. Once again, George,
go figure. Right?
Let me go on the record right now. I do not have a book coming out.
Okay? No, so you don't.
I'm not selling a book, nor am I pushing any particular theories on the shroud, but I was privileged to be a part of it and study it and see it firsthand and hold it in my hands for 5 days and nights. And
what did it feel like, by the way? And,
well, you know,
I want to get into your work in just a second, but
sure,
what did it feel like to touch the Shroud of Turin?